He is the Word of God, a prophet, a servant. He is the bread of life, the shepherd and the lamb. He is the messenger. He is the humble king. He is the Son of God. He was rejected and abandoned. He was betrayed and condemned. He was mocked and beaten, bruised and pierced. He was crucified and buried. But the nails could not hold him. The cross could not finish him. The stone could not keep him. Death could not defeat him. He is our ransom and our redeemer. He is our deliverer and our refuge. He is mighty. He is glorious. He is holy and exalted. He is our Savior.
Risen, yeah, that does deserve a round of applause. He is risen. That is great news for all of us, every one of us. Welcome to our service, our special Easter Sunday service. Why don't you stand with us, and we're going to enter into a time of worship, praising our God who is risen and alive. Let's do this together.
Was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. I try to hide. You was my tomb, Jesus, till I met you. When you called my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness to your glorious day. You called
stay. Now your mercy.
Now your mercy has saved my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old man knew Jesus when I out of the darkness to your glorious land. You called my name. I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness to your glorious day. Break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. You called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. And your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. When you called my name, I ran out of that grave. The dark.
glorious day. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. Just think about that picture for a moment. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay." What an invitation to come and see, to come and share in this great story of resurrection and life together. And Jesus offers that to every one of us. And so now as we continue to worship, we claim these words and we're singing that he is alive. And we believe that. Amen. Let's worship our God together.
Sun was dead, the Savior of the world was fallen, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
Alive.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
Overcome this morning. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you have overcome. Lord, thank you that millions around this world today are celebrating. Lord, they're celebrating that you overcome death, Lord, that you did this for us so that we can be free. Amen. He is risen. Ah, he is risen. Well done. Why don't you turn to someone around you and do this beautiful Easter Sunday greeting. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Welcome, welcome to Brackenridge this morning. Please take a seat. Feel free to continue those greetings after the service. It'd be beautiful. My name is Lee and I'm the care pastor here at the Grow at Brackenridge. I'll get that right another time. If you are new this morning, we want to say welcome to you. If you're watching online and unable to make it to our Easter Sunday service, we want to welcome to you too. If you are new, there is going to be tea and coffee after the service, so feel free to join us for a morning tea. That'll be beautiful. If you are new, there is connect cards up the back. If you'd like to know more information about anything here at Brackenridge, if you'd love to get our weekly e-newsletters, there's connect cards that you can fill in and pop them into the box at the end of the service. Kids, today is special Easter Sunday, obviously, but there is no kids' church on this morning. But parents, if your kids need it, we do have the annex open and there's a whole heap of stuff in there, and the service is watched online as well. So parents, feel free to take your kids over there if they need to do that this morning. Now, we are grateful for everyone who gives financially to this church, to the many ministries that we do. They can't be done without your generosity, so we want to thank you for that. If you would like to give an offering today, there's information up on the screen. You can do that through direct debit or online, or in the foyer there's a little FBOS machine, and for the good people that still do cash, there's an offering box as well. Now, we have some great things coming up tonight at our 5 p.m. service. Our p.m. service is actually moving to 5 p.m. and we're moving from here to Shorncliffe to do some worship at the water, and we're going to have more baptisms there. This morning we have two baptisms, and tonight we'll have two more for Gabby and Tom being baptized. So if you'd like to find out more information about that, you can find where people are meeting down on the website as well. You can go visit that. We've got a lot more things coming up in the life of the church on the 13th of April. There's a men's night coming up, 6:30 p.m. $15, that's a bargain. That's including dinner. Now, you can get $15, you can get a Macca's meal, or you can get a really good dinner here. So, men, if you'd like to come along, that's on the 13th of April, and you can register online. On the 14th, the very next day, we have at our 9 a.m. service, we're going to be having the official opening of our Eden Cafe next door, which we're really excited about. This space has been converted by some amazing people in our church into a cafe that we would love to use after church on a Sunday, but also throughout the week in all of our ministries. It's already being used a little bit, but we're really looking forward to it being used a lot more. So come along on the 14th of April and you'll be able to do that. Coming up as well in just after Christmas, I know that's a far way away, but we need to be thinking now. There's some Thailand trip being organised, approximately the 27th of December to the 12th of January. And the mission trip's being organised to visit and work with the Mercy International Children's villages in Thailand there. The church has been doing this for a few years and then COVID hit, but we're keen to start that up again. So if you're interested in coming, the cost is, we're looking at about $2,500, but if you'd like to register your interest, you can do that online, or you can talk to one of the staff members here as well. Now, coming up as well in May, we have Alpha starting. So if you are have questions about Christianity, if you are a new Christian, if you are searching about faith, or you're just, would just like to know more about Jesus and that kind of stuff, or if you have friends and family that are constantly asking you questions and you don't quite know what to say or how to say it, this course is a really great course for you to do. So we're starting that on the 5th of April at our new time of our PM service at 5 p.m. And that course will run over a few weeks, and it includes a meal, it includes a video, and it includes small group discussion. And that's a really great chance to ask questions, get some really great thinking and stuff around who is this Jesus guy and what's all this about. So you can register with that online if you're coming to the 5 p.m. service. It's also going to be run in life groups as well. So if you're interested in joining a life group that might be running that course, you can speak to Dave Ang about that as well. Now, kids and adults, I wonder if you got some yummy Easter eggs this morning. Put your hands up if you got some yummy Easter eggs. I wonder if you can keep your hands up if you've already eaten all your Easter eggs. Oh, I think there's a few out there that have already eaten their Easter eggs, but there's some well-restrained people who haven't eaten their Easter eggs. We're just going to watch a video now about a very special Easter.
What do you like about Easter?
Celebrate with your family.
Easter hunting for eggs.
You get to open them and there's stuff in there.
Money and grass.
Lots of candy.
What does the Easter bunny do?
Hops. He hides the eggs.
He's a person that's dressed up in a costume.
Who is Jesus?
Jesus is like a person God.
He is God's son.
What does Jesus look like?
Long brown hair and a brown beard.
And he's got like a robe on.
He has this belt, like what karate people wear, I think.
Who are the disciples?
12 chosen followers of Jesus.
Simon, Peter, Andrew, James, John, Philip, Thomas, Matthew, James, and Thaddeus, Simon, Judas, Bartholomew.
They're the good guys.
What did Jesus teach?
How to pray and that God's real. To always love one another when it's hard.
Teaching them about Christmas and Valentine's Day.
What kinds of miracles did Jesus do?
He turned water into wine.
He made 5 loaves and 2 fishes spread a long way.
He helped people if they were sick.
He walked on water.
There was a storm and it was all windy and they said, Jesus, Jesus. And then he calmed it down so they won't be scared.
What would be a really cool miracle for him to do?
For me to be a superhero like Batman.
Let me ride a shark.
Fix the government.
What did they eat at the Last Supper?
Bread and like some dipping sauce.
Chicken nuggets and french fries.
And there's the juice.
Some vegetables with chocolate on it.
Why did some people not like Jesus?
That everybody was calling him king.
They didn't believe that he was God's son.
They thought he would only hang out with the people who had done no sin, but he helped the sinners because they're the ones who needed help.
What did those people do to Jesus?
There were swords
trying to capture him, whipped him,
and put a crown of thorns on his head,
and made him carry the cross a long way,
put him on a cross and stabbed him.
They hurted his heart.
He died on Good Friday.
And then somebody put him in a tomb that had this big rock over it.
What happened on Sunday morning?
He grew from the ground.
He rose from the dead.
What did the disciples do when they saw Jesus?
Very afraid, thought he was a ghost.
They saw the scars, they touched him.
Jesus, Jesus is alive, and I love him.
They were so happy.
How do we follow Jesus?
Confess our sins.
And ask him into our heart by praying.
And then he's like in our heart.
Why did Jesus do all of this?
It was all for us because he loves us.
He said, I don't want them to be scared. And whenever they're hurt, I want to help them.
We love you, Jesus.
Just beautiful. And there you go, kids. There's something I never knew before or haven't tried before. Broccoli with chocolate. So there's something for this Easter for you all. Hey, it's a really special Sunday for so many reasons. We get to celebrate the new life of Jesus, celebrate the life that we have in Jesus. We also get to now celebrate 2 baptisms, which is really, really exciting as we get to witness together 2 people being baptized. We're going to hear from them in just a moment. Before we do, I'd like to just take a couple of minutes just to try and put some thoughts around what baptism is for all of us. So we're just thinking about what's going on here. Because Jesus himself, when he was on the earth, before he died, was baptized himself. In Matthew 3, we see that Jesus goes to the Jordan River, and there he is baptized by John the Baptist. And John the Baptist, he comes up to Jesus and he says, I'm not the one, you should be baptizing me, Jesus, here, not the other way around. But Jesus says to him, he says, let it be so now, because it's proper for us to do this to fulfill all righteousness. And who is John to not consent to that? Jesus also, as he went about with his mission on earth, during his time on earth, he spoke about baptism as well. In the Great Commission, after he dies and has come back, the final words, his parting words before he ascends to heaven to be with the Father, is this. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And then he says these words, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you.
And surely I'm with you always, even to the very end of the age. So baptism we see as a part of Jesus' ministry. It's included in his final words as he commissions his followers. So there's a relevance, there's an importance there as he speaks out those words about being baptized in the name of the Father and the Son. And then finally, in Romans chapter 6, the Apostle Paul, who has lots to say on baptism, he teaches that baptism is a symbol of dying and of rising again with Christ anew. Dying and rising with Christ. And so baptism, the symbolism is as we go under the water, as our two baptizees go under the water this morning, there is this symbol of being made dead to ourself, our old way of living. And then as they rise up out of the water, they recognize that they have been made alive and they have been made new and clean in Jesus himself. So as we go under the water, the old self is buried and we come up out of the water, which is symbolic of that new life in Jesus. A beautiful picture, baptism. And today on Easter Sunday, we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus, raised to life for every single one of us. And we have this morning two people, as I said, Ulrich and Rachel being baptized. I want to especially welcome friends and family. If you've come along to support Ulrich and Rachel this morning, you're very welcome here, and it's great to have you with us as well as a part of our time together celebrating. As a part of them being baptized this morning, Ulrich and Rachel are publicly saying they recognize that new life that Jesus has given to them individually. That's something that is real in their lives. They're saying their old self is gone and their new self is here in Jesus. And by being baptized this morning, they are declaring that Jesus is the one who lives in them and that they are committing their lives to following him and his way of living, not their own way, as a part of being baptized. And so today as well, we are all witnesses to their baptism and to their declaration, and we get to celebrate and join and share with them this amazing stand that they are making for Jesus this morning. And we're really excited for all God has in store for Ulrich and Rachel into the future from this day forward, and everything that God has been doing in their lives to this point in time as well. Just before we get to our testimony time where we get to hear some of their story, if anything that I've spoken about this morning, just then in that brief short amount of time, raises any questions for you, we would love to chat more about baptism with you. Please come and see a member of staff, and we would love to share in conversation with you about baptism. If you sense that it is something that you're being called to, we'd love to hear from you. So please come forward and have a chat to one of us after the service. And so now we come to this time where we get to hear the testimony or the story of our two people being baptized. And we are going to hear from Ulrich first. So can you please make Ulrich feel really, really welcome as he comes on forward? Thanks, Ulrich. The microphone is all yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ulrich, and I'm really excited to take this next step forward in my faith as I get baptized here today. I've always known about God, about the story of Jesus and the gospel. I was born into a Christian family who regularly taught me from the scripture from my earliest understanding, of which I'm very thankful. It was thanks to my parents that I was allowed to go to a private Christian school, where my understanding of biblical truths and teachings was greatly supported, and I was fostered in a caring and helpful Christian community. However, up until what I believe to be around 1.5 years ago, I never really took ownership of my faith. I had always accepted everything that I heard from those important to me without ever actually challenging my beliefs or discerning what made sense to me as an individual. This changed dramatically when I was 17, and I was fueled with a genuine desire for truth as I sought after Christ and his kingdom. This led me to understand and learn so much more about the nature of salvation and what it means to follow Christ, prompting a conviction within me to get baptized earlier this year. In my baptism this morning, not only am I declaring my faith publicly, but I'm also being obedient to Christ as we've been commanded to repent and be baptized. Ever since genuinely accepting Christ as an individual, my life has shown genuine change. I have been able to mature so much more in understanding, following Christ in seriousness, and eluding my past foolishness. I feel so much more conviction now in everything that I do, fostering a genuine desire to do everything as though I were doing it directly for God. I've also been led faithfully by God to reflect this change to the world, spreading the love of Christ not in words alone, but also in action. I'm so very thankful to God and all those that he has sent to lead me to him in truth, and I hope that my baptism today may reinforce this and act as a foundation for my further development in my relationship with Christ and growth in theological understanding. Romans chapter 6, verse 4 says, "We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." I hope that today, as I am baptized into death, that I may be raised from the dead as Christ rose again, and that I may move forward truly appreciating the newness of life and salvation that he has blessed me with. Thank you.
Well, thank you for sharing, Ulrich. We're going to move to a time now where we are making our way into the baptism pool. I'd like to invite the band to come forward. Ulrich has chosen a song, "How Great Thou Art," a great chorus for us to sing as a part of his baptism as we make our way to the pool. The baptism is going to be on the screen after we've sung the song, so you can watch from the screen, but I'd like to invite friends and family, if you'd like to come forward during this song and get a bird's eye view or an up-close view, please feel free to come forward. Please feel free to come forward. Try and say that 5 times fast during this song, and that'd be great. Okay, so let's sing this song together, and please make your way forward if you'd like to come forward.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not spared, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Ulrich has asked his father, Chris, to pray for him. So, Chris, would you come forward and pray for Ulrich now?
Dear Heavenly Father, What an amazing privilege, Lord. To see your son follow you in this final step, the start of his journey, Lord. I praise your name for the journey that you've taken him on, that he continues to grow and ground himself in your word. I pray, Lord, today a blessing on him, that you will guide him through your Holy Spirit, and that you will lead him in wisdom, and that he will stay grounded and follow you all the days of his life, and that you would bless each step he takes, and that you will refresh him day by day and guide him on his journey. I pray this in the wonderful, glorious name of Jesus. Amen.
Yes. Well, Ulrich, actually just stand for a second. Ulrich, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross and he was raised again for the forgiveness of your sins?
I do.
And Ulrich, do you promise to serve him as a part of his church for all of your days?
I do.
That's great news. And therefore, Ulrich, on confession of this, I baptize you now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Stand with us as we lift our voices to him, as we sing, "Then Sings My Soul."
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul. Shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, "My God, how great thou art."
Then sings my soul.
Then sings my soul. Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Let's praise Jesus this morning for Ulrich's baptism. You can take a seat. So, so good. Such a celebration. It is my joy and honor to invite Rachel up here now. Come on, Rach, up you come. Give her a clap as she comes up. It's been wonderful getting to know Rachel and her beautiful kids as well, Tim, Sam, and Abby. And it's exciting today to hear how God has been moving in your life and how you've come to make this decision to be baptized today. So I'm going to give you the microphone and we can hear some of your story.
How good is God? He's so cool. So this is very exciting, sharing what God's done in my life and in my family.
I grew up in a really strict Presbyterian Reformed church, and it was really drummed into you, you're a sinner and you're not worthy. You're not worthy. Not worthy of God's grace. And I can remember as a little kid lying in bed and being absolutely terrified I was going to hell. I knew I was bad. I knew it. There was a little voice inside my head that would just whisper to me, you're broken. You're not worthy. You're a reject. And as I grew older, this little voice grew stronger with all those wounds that you receive as you go through life. And it started to change a little bit. It told me that I wasn't just unworthy, but that I was worthless. I was worthless. A reject. Unlovable. Alone. To fast forward 20 years, I found myself married with my three beautiful children. And shortly after the birth of my first son, my husband was diagnosed with bipolar disorder. And for 10 desperate years, I watched as his health and his grip on reality deteriorated. And along with these health challenges came the devastation of the downward spiral of first verbal and then physical abuse. And that little voice in my head became a literal voice coming from the one who should have been my greatest protector. That little voice in my head was the only voice I could hear now. It shouted, you're stupid. You're worthless. Who could love you? You're alone. There came a point last year where I found myself at absolute rock bottom, at the very end of myself. I was divorced. I was alone and the sole provider of my three precious kids. And I had $3 to my name. And over a two-week period, my father-in-law passed away. And then a very dear friend of over 30 years also passed away. And then in that same 2 weeks, another friend very shockingly committed suicide. And I could barely function. My grief was so great. And I remember one night in the middle of the night just crying out to God with the words that David cried out, how long, Lord? Will you forget me forever? How long will you hide from me? How long must I wrestle with these thoughts and have this grief in my heart? And in the midst of that anguish, I heard a voice, and it was a different voice. And it just whispered to me, be still. And I desperately wanted to hear that voice again. And I started reading and reading and reading over the next few months. And through his words, Jesus confronted me with a question. Who do you say that I am? You've known about me from the time you were a little girl. Who do you say that I am? Either I'm a madman and a complete liar, or I am who I say I am. I say that I am the way, the truth, and the life. If I am the truth, who's this other voice you've been listening to? Because those aren't my words. In fact, that voice sounds a lot like the voice one of my other precious daughters listened to back in the Garden of Eden. My Eve listened to that voice. It told her, you won't die. Did God say that? No. He knows if you eat that fruit, you'll be just like him. You'll know everything. That voice tells you that you're unloved. I say, the mountains may be removed and the hills may shake, but my love for you will never be removed. As high as the heavens are above the earth, that's how much I love you. That voice tells you that you're rejected by man and by me. But I say, you are precious to me. I've chosen you. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Your name is engraved on the palm of my hands. That voice tells you you're utterly alone. But I say, don't be afraid. I am with you. You are not alone. Don't be anxious. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold you up with my hands. That voice tells you that you are unworthy. But I, Jesus, I am worthy. I am your righteousness. Yes, your sins are like scarlet, but they'll be like snow. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far I have taken your sin from you. I have given my life in exchange with you, so I can be with you always. I am the way. I am the truth. I'm the life. I came so that you may have that life abundantly. I came to turn your mourning into dancing. I came so that your joy may be full. I came to give you my peace. So choose today. Who are you going to serve? Which voice are you going to listen to? Who will you follow? And I'm here this morning to say, I choose Jesus. I choose Jesus. I believe his words. I repent and I believe in my Jesus. He is my Lord and Savior. He has died for me. He is the only way. He is the absolute truth, and he is my life.
Amen, amen. So good. Thank you for sharing with us this morning, Rachel. God is so good, and you came up here and you declared that straight away. You said, how good is God? He is so, so good. We get to head over to the water now and dunk you and praise God for how good he is. And that is so exciting. So Rachel has chosen a song this morning, In Christ Alone, a beautiful, beautiful song that we're going to worship together with. If you have been on a journey with Rachel and got to know her family, friends, please head down the front and support her this morning. I'm sure the kids are already getting up to support you down there, Rachel. But we're going to head over there and we're going to start singing this song together. Thank you, band. Let's head over, Rach.
In Christ alone, is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, from through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, where fears are still, when striving cease. My only goal, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in of love and righteousness. righteousness scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live.
I'm just going to invite Lee to come now to pray for Rachel. Thank you so much, Lee.
Thank you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful child of yours, Lord. Lord, she has gone through the valleys. Those feelings of alone, those feelings of worthlessness. But Lord, you have rescued her, Father. We thank you for that small voice that night. Lord, you never leave her, you never forsake her, Lord. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you gave her a new name, Lord. You have given her a name of worthy. You have given her a name of daughter. You have given her a name of strength and dignity. And today, Lord, she is yours. Father, today she stands here and she says, Jesus, you are mine. Lord, we thank you that she is standing here today. We thank you for this commitment that she's making, Lord. And Father, we do pray that going forward, she may continue to hear those voices in the hard times, Lord. May that voice never go away, Lord. May she always know how much she is loved by you, Lord. And Father, we thank you that today she is just standing here saying, Jesus, I love you. She's saying it back. Father, we thank you for Rachel today. Amen.
Rachel, do you believe that Jesus died on the cross and was raised again for the forgiveness of your sins?
I do.
And do you promise to serve him as a part of your church, for all of his church, for all the days of your life?
Yes, I do.
Well, therefore, I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands,
please stand with us as we sing this victory.
Sin's curse has been lost,
his grip on me.
For I am his, he is mine. What with the precious from his hands till he returns.
pray together. King Jesus, we praise you this morning because you are alive, because you are risen. And because you are alive, that means there is new life available for us. And so we thank you, King Jesus, for these stories that we have heard this morning. Lord, let's really pray for all of us this morning that we might contemplate, that we might understand once again afresh the life that you have been able to give every single one of us through your resurrection. And so we celebrate that this morning as your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, don't grab a seat just yet because I have something to say to you and I'll need you to respond with me. There is a traditional Easter greeting, which is He is risen, and you need to respond with He is risen indeed. And so I'm going to do that right now. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Fantastic. You can grab a seat, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you here this morning as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus together as his people and as we celebrate new life through the waters of baptism. It's always wonderful to see people getting baptized and demonstrating and declaring their faith in Jesus. The whole point of baptism is to symbolize this new life that a person has experienced, because Jesus himself, here on Easter, we celebrate that he has experienced new life. Because he was raised to life, now we can experience new life. And as Dave discussed before, baptism is a symbol of all of this. For me, there was a point in my own life that I experienced this new life when I was about 15 years old. I was a teenager walking along the beach at Currumundi, and something changed in me in how I viewed God. I looked over the waves of the water and my eyes were opened to the love and the goodness of God in a whole new way, and I received his love for myself. And the key thing for me in this moment was not hearing any new information. I wasn't having some emotionally charged experience. Rather, my eyes were simply opened to a truth that I already knew. Most of you here this morning, for those of you joining with us online as well, you will know at least at some level the truths of the resurrection. You've probably come to an Easter service for many years of your life, and you've heard the news that Jesus has risen again from the dead. And we come here to celebrate that this morning because we look back with hindsight and we can see who Jesus truly was when we look through the gospel accounts and when we look at all the people who have celebrated this over generations. But on the morning that Jesus rose again from the dead, people didn't wake up with gladness. They didn't wake up with singing. The only people who did were probably the religious leaders at that time. Easter morning came and there was weeping and there was sorrow. This was not beginning as a day of celebration. It began with people who couldn't see what had happened. According to most of the people who would have been there, the disciples and the other people who knew Jesus, the morning came and they would have thought Jesus was still dead in the grave. He had been whipped and beaten and crucified, and they saw that with their own eyes. No one knew that Jesus had risen from the grave, and they were stuck in this darkness without the ability to be able to see what had been going on. But then bit by bit throughout the day, there's this journey that seems to take place where more and more people see what has taken place until you reach the point of people really getting it. And they acknowledge, yes, Jesus really did rise again from the dead. And we see this taking place in the Gospel of John in chapter 20. Now, this resurrection account in the Gospel of John isn't one that maybe we usually use when it comes to Easter time. This is a little bit different from the other Gospel accounts in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And the reason for this is because John is writing with a very specific purpose. And you can read about this purpose in the very last two verses of chapter 20. It's a very artistic book, and it's full of grand language, and it's very, very Jewish, like the whole gospel account that John chooses to write. It's not John's goal to write a step-by-step historical account, but rather he takes us on this unfolding journey to display who Jesus really is and what was happening for the people around Jesus at this time. And in chapter 20, John is trying to take us on a similar journey to what the people would have gone through on this Easter Sunday. And so, yeah, if you have a Bible, please open up to John 20, and we're going to be looking primarily at verses 1 to 10. And it says this, it'll be on the screen as well. It says, early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter, a cute little side note that he puts in there, and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. And then finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. And then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Throughout our lives, how we see things will develop. This is very much true, of course, in our perspective of things. Can we go to the next slide, please, Barb? That would be great, thank you. But also in how we literally see things. And you can see here on the screen some of the different ways that we will see things in the first year of our life. In the first 6 months of someone's life, their vision will develop hugely. They will go from being able to barely recognize colors and being virtually blind to being able to see similar things to what we do as adults. Now, just for reference, I did check over all of this information with Alex Sweetman throughout the week, who is also an optometrist, so you can trust what I'm saying is true. An organization called the Lozier Institute of Charlotte says this about our vision and how it develops. What can newborns see? Well, newborns have poor eyesight, in part because they did not get much visual information in the womb. At birth, the average baby's visual acuity is 20 to 640, meaning that an object that an average adult can see 640 feet away would need to be just 20 feet away in order for the baby to see it. For perspective, a person is legally blind if their visual acuity is 20 to 200 or worse. Thankfully, the infant's visual acuity improves quickly. At 1 month old, the average acuity is 20 to 235. At 6 months old, the average acuity is 20 to 60. By 3 years old, the average acuity is pretty close to an adult's acuity, 20 to 25. Newborns also lack depth perception, which develops around 4 months old. What we see throughout this short account throughout John's Gospel is an unfolding, a building of seeing the risen Jesus. It's like in this chapter and in these first 10 verses, they move from a newborn perception of the resurrection to an adult seeing of the resurrection. There is this journey that takes place of looking to contemplating to believing. They don't arrive at the tomb, see what has taken place, and immediately think, Jesus isn't here. He's risen. He's alive. Hallelujah. Well, let's worship him together right now. In fact, Mary's first words are, they have taken him from the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him. From this point on, the attention moves from Mary and moves to these two disciples, Peter and John, John who wrote this gospel account. We know that it's John because John has this cocky way of referring to himself throughout his writings as the one that Jesus loved. After Mary says this to Peter and John, they rush to the empty tomb. And once again, John finds it necessary to point out the fact that he got to the tomb first and won the running race against Peter. And then John looks and sees some strips of linen lying there on the ground. He doesn't go into the tomb, but he's able to see the linen that Jesus had been wearing. The first word that's used here by John in seeing the linen is the word blepo. Everyone say blepo. It means that he simply looked at the linen. This is the most basic form of looking. It's what we do most of the time as we go through our lives. We might be walking along and see a step that we need to walk up, and our brains automatically process that we need to take a step up. It's how our brains are usually wired in how we see different things happening around us. It's the most basic form of seeing. On the screen, you can see a picture of my son, Zechariah, on the night that he was born. And even back then, he had a big head. When he was born, he couldn't smile. He couldn't move. He couldn't hold his head up. I'm not surprised. And he also couldn't see very much. His eyes were closed consistently. And when they were open, there wouldn't have been much that he would have been able to see. In the corner, you can see what a newborn's vision is like. Colors are muted. They can see light and dark, but they can't see much more than that. It's like the equivalent of our peripheral vision, which we actually rely on a lot for our everyday lives. Now, John's picture of how he looked at the linen is like this. It's almost like he looked past the linen and barely noticed it. It didn't sink in at all that this was Jesus' clothes and that Jesus wasn't there. So it's blurry to him that there is just some fabric on the ground. This is how many people in our world think about Jesus today. They view Jesus in a blurry sort of way, in a blepo sort of way. They know that there was this guy, Jesus, this Jewish rabbi, who taught some people about 2,000 years ago, and that lots of people around the world call themselves followers of Jesus. But other than that, they might look straight past him and not notice a thing. Now, for some of you here this morning or joining with us online, that might be you here. That might be your understanding this morning. You've come here with a family member because you had to. You don't really want to think about this Jesus stuff. Easter might just, all it might be to you is just a series of great public holidays that come throughout the year. And you might just be wanting this guy up the front to shut up so that you can get to your Easter lunch that you are going to be having. But John, he almost doesn't give you the opportunity of staying in that place. He doesn't stop by just staying outside of the tomb. Peter eventually catches up and he runs straight past John and into the empty tomb. Now, once again, this is so much like the rest of Peter's life. Peter is rapidly moving, not really thinking about what is going on, and he rushes into the tomb. Just recognize here the hot-headedness of Peter in this moment. He is not stopping when he's arriving at a grave. And this is a very fresh grave. This is the grave of someone who has recently been dead. Not for decades, but someone who only died a few days earlier. Personally, I wouldn't be rushing in as quickly as Peter does, but he wants to know what is going on as soon as he can. And when he arrives inside the tomb, he doesn't just casually look at the linen like John did, but he stops suddenly and begins to contemplate what is going on. His mind begins racing as he sees the linen there. He's not just looking, he is contemplating at the significance of this moment. The word used here for Peter seeing, can we go to the next slide please, Barb? The word used here for Peter seeing the strips of linen is this word theoreo. And it is one step further on from what John was doing when he saw the empty tomb and the linen that Jesus had been wrapped up in. This word theoreo, it's where we get the word theater and theory. So at the theater, you will concentrate more heavily than if you are just walking along a sidewalk. When you're engaging with a form of theory, you are focusing more intently on it. It has the idea of understanding or meditating or focusing on something and using your mind to a greater extent than just looking at something. A few years ago, I was waiting at the airport for a flight, and I was just sitting down casually, looking at different people who were walking past, and I saw from a bit of a distance someone starting to walk past me, and I recognized this person. They were wearing a cap and a hoodie, so it was harder for me to know who they were. Now, I've met a lot of people through ministry I've done at different churches, and sometimes it can take me a little while to process, where do I know this person from again? So I kept my eyes pretty fixed on this person. I was going through my brain archives, and they kept walking closer and eventually began walking past me. I smiled at them, still not really able to recognize them, and I said, "Oh, hey, mate," and they gave me a quick, semi-grumpy look and kept walking past. And almost as soon as this person walked past me, I recognized who they were. It was Matthew Hayden, the Australian cricketer and previously the opening batsman for the Australian cricket team. So there's no relationship there at all. He doesn't know me at all. I kept looking at him. I was focused on trying to figure out who this guy was, but it wasn't quite clicking for me. I was concentrating and contemplating, but there was this barrier in my mind from taking the next step. And this is the idea of theoreo. This is the idea of how Peter approached how he viewed the tomb after running inside. As Zek began to grow, a huge amount changed in the first 3 months. He was able to smile, but more than that, he was beginning to recognize certain people and things as his sight began to change. Between months 2 to 4, babies will start to recognize their parents and primary caregivers. And so at 3 months, Zek would have hit this point of being able to recognize to some level who I was. They can perceive who they are and know, oh, that's the person I spend lots of time with. Cool. It seems at this stage for babies, there is an understanding and increasing awareness of who someone is, but it doesn't necessarily really change anything for them. They still poop and sleep and feed. Their level of awareness hasn't necessarily changed much for them in what they do in their life. Now, some people will be like this in how they see Jesus. They contemplate. They have a level of awareness, but then that stops in how they see him. These are the people who might say that they're a Christian, but have never really taken the step of placing their trust in Jesus. This would be many, many people who are going to church today on Easter. You've spent time thinking about Jesus. You may even believe in the resurrection. You may believe in the Bible. You might occasionally pray and come to church when it feels good to you, but that's the point when it stops. But once again, John doesn't allow us to simply stop at this point of contemplating who Jesus is. His goal is not for us to understand facts about Jesus or the resurrection. His goal is that we might genuinely believe, that might impact who we are. John and Peter, they've run to the tomb, speaking to Mary Magdalene. John arrives first and looks at the empty linen. When Peter arrives, he enters into the tomb and contemplates what this might mean. But then John begins to make his way into the tomb itself, and something seems to click for him in this moment. He sees, and he believes. This time, John beholds, perceives, observes, really, and then he believes. This final word is a word of seeing that comes from the word horeo, which means to not just look, it means more than contemplating, it means really, genuinely believing what you are seeing. Now, the strange thing that happens here is that just after it says that John believed, it says they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Now, when I first read this, I was trying to figure out what was actually being said here. Did John believe in the resurrection or did he not? Because it sounds like he does and then he doesn't. Now, in this moment, John saw what had taken place. He beholds the empty tomb and he believes that Jesus has risen again from the dead, but he's not able to put all of the pieces together or figure it all out 100% at this stage. Now, for many people in the Western world, and for us 2,000 years later, many people will still struggle to understand the resurrection, but for different reasons. Many people struggle to understand the resurrection because of science. It's not a scientific, it's not an event that might be consistent with people's scientific understanding. Someone being raised again from the dead is not something that happens every single day in the realm of science. And that, for many people, can be their greatest struggle in understanding the resurrection of Jesus. But for John 2,000 years ago, that's not his struggle. That's not his hang-up. That's not the thing that he is unable to understand about what's going on. What he's unable to understand is how all the pieces of Scripture from the Old Testament come together to reach this point where Jesus has risen again from the dead. But the incredible thing that we see here is that although he doesn't necessarily understand the resurrection, he can't put all the pieces together, he still believes. He doesn't necessarily understand, but he believes. We don't know what Peter was thinking at this point, but it almost seems like both of them at some moment have this moment of horeo, of seeing and believing that Jesus has risen again from the dead. Later on, we see the end of the disciples' story in verses 19 to 20. It says, on the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. The disciples, including Peter and John, in this moment, they encounter the risen Jesus. And all of them together, they believe. They have this moment of horeo. Our son Zach, he turned 1 year old a couple of months ago. And at this age, his sight is similar to that of an adult. I didn't check that information with Alex, but I saw it online, so hopefully that's true. It's still developing somewhat, but he's able to know colors and depth in a way that is very similar to that of an adult. He can see things more clearly. And that's part of what horeo means. It means that we can clearly see that Jesus really did rise from the dead. And that's what happened for John and Peter here. But there's also another aspect to horeo. One of the things that Zek has always been able to do, and some of you have experienced this, is he's been able to go around to other people fairly easily. Part of being a pastor's kid is he might get handed around a little bit. And I love that. I love that he spends so much time with the rest of his church family and is willing to spend time with many of you. From what I understand, not every child of his age is like this, but I have no one else to base things off, so I've been pretty happy for him to go to other people and for me to rest my arms at certain times. But I have had moments where I've thought in the back of my mind, do you really know who I am? He definitely knows who Sarah is as his mum, but I've wondered, does he really know me as his dad? Or am I just a guy that spends a lot more time with him than everyone else? Does he just see me like one of these other people? This hasn't really been an active thought of mine, but it's been there somewhat in the back of my mind. Recently, he's been teething. He had 4 teeth coming through at once, and he's just been super grumpy, which is fair enough. I'd be grumpy too. He's been in a lot of pain and has been really clingy. And whilst his teething has been going on, there was a morning I needed to look after him. But on this morning, I was also doing some pre-marriage counselling for a couple. Zach was really clingy on this morning. And on this morning, this couple came around to my house and we sat in my living area. We just had some very general chit-chat and I asked the girl if she wanted to hold Zach. And like most girls, she very much wanted to. But as soon as I began to lift him off my chest, he began to get really distressed. He grabbed onto my shirt and would not let go. He wanted to be held by his dad. For the next half an hour or so, he just rested on me. As I spoke to this couple about marriage, and he just clung to me, not wanting to leave. For most people, it wouldn't mean that much. But I was actually thrilled. For me, it felt like Zach didn't just see me as father or just a guy who he spends a lot of time with, but he knew me as dad. Someone who is safe, protective, and warm. Dad's the one who makes everything better. Dad is the one who I want to be with. And for me, it felt like at some moment, everything clicked for Zach. He believed. For the next half an hour, I didn't do the best job of pre-marriage counseling as Zach held on to me, because I was just excited in the fact that it felt like something clicked for Zach. Zach didn't just look at me as father or guardian, but he believed and knew in the depth of his being that I was his dad and that I was there for him. And that impacted how he interacted with me. Horeo means that we can see that clearly Jesus really did rise again from the dead. That's part of it. But it also means that we believe in him. It means that something clicks for us and our seeing becomes believing. We believe that because Jesus rose from the dead, what he said about himself was really true. And if we believe that, then we turn from living our lives our own way, we trust in him, and restore our relationship with God as our Father. Believing in the resurrection of Jesus automatically leads to action on our part. It's a depth of seeing that goes past just contemplation or looking and leads to a deeper place within our lives. This journey that we see Peter and John taking here from looking to contemplating to believing, this takes place three times within this chapter. We see this when the disciples see Jesus, but we see this also when Mary Magdalene sees Jesus, and then also when Thomas sees Jesus. All of these different narratives take people on a journey of how they see Jesus. And in the very last verse, John effectively leaves us with this, with a statement about Jesus, but he also leaves us with a question. How will you see Jesus? He takes us through these different stories and leaves you with this question. How are you going to see Jesus? Worship team, if you'd like to come up, that'd be great. Will you simply look at him? Will you just know that there was this Jewish rabbi who taught about 2,000 years ago and lots of people call themselves his followers, but other than that, you're not really that interested? Will you just contemplate his resurrection? You might have a level of awareness of the resurrection of Jesus, but then you might stop in how you see him. Will you, you might just call yourself a Christian, but have never really taken that place of believing, that step of believing in Jesus? Or will you believe in him and his resurrection? Will you see the empty tomb and believe that he really did rise again from the dead and allow this to shape and frame how you view everything about God? Will you allow this belief to take you past seeing, past looking, past contemplating, into believing and genuinely following Jesus? Now, because you are here in church today, and because those of you are joining with us online, most people, I'm guessing, probably won't be in the just looking at Jesus stage. Many of you maybe aren't even in the contemplating camp, but you would say that you believe in Jesus. You would say that that's how you see him. When the disciples saw Jesus and believed, it says that they were overjoyed in verse 20. They weren't just joyful, but they were overflowing with joy because Jesus had risen again. They moved from this place at the beginning of Easter where their eyes were closed to fully seeing in all of his glory the risen Jesus there on Easter Sunday. Now, many of us who have seen and believed, we are filled with joy when we first comprehend the resurrection of Jesus. We are overflowing with joy because of what we have seen. But bit by bit, our eyes can wander. And although we say we believe, we stop looking towards the risen Jesus and we begin to look past him towards the things of this world again. But the resurrection of Jesus is that point for everyone who believes to bring their eyes back to the risen King, to be overflowing with joy once again because Jesus has risen from the grave. And that means good news for you and for me. And that's what Easter is all about. When you see Jesus risen from the grave and believe in him, you should be filled with joy once again if you believe. Amen? Let's stand together and we're going to sing, and we're going to sing with joy in the hope that we have in our King Jesus. Let's sing together.
church. This is what we believe. Then came the our living hope, and we have a reason to praise Him. So let's close our service by praising the Lord together. I'll praise.
Praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my fears are all drowned in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. Still in control.
be very blessed this Easter as we celebrate the risen Jesus. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Please hang around and grab a coffee with us. We would love to get to know you. And then join us tonight as we celebrate two more baptisms at the water tonight. Just head online if you want to see the details for that. God bless.